Okay.
Whew. So, I'm at this Econo Lodge. But anyway, I like this place. See, look, I'm like a... Actually, I guess unofficially, I'm still on my unsequestered monk tour. But that, don't worry about that stuff. Because, you know, I just like to... I live like I'm like a monk. You know, St. Anthony, the first monk. Get it? Okay, it doesn't matter. Look, just had breakfast, you know, continental breakfast. Now, see, I like dark chocolate, right? So I saw the dark chocolate package, you know. So I was pouring a little bit of water in there, you know, hot water into the cup first and put the thing in. And then I realized, whoa, hey, they got coffee here. I don't do coffee, but I'm going like, whoa, let's think about this, right? So I put two. Anyway, my point is I put the dark chocolate in there, put coffee in it. So this is coffee and dark chocolate. I like it. By the way, for those of you people who drink coffee, don't drink it past, you know, 12 o'clock. You know, just one cup, two cups, whatever. You don't go that far. And there's an Indian guy at the thing. I mean, from India. You know, I was talking to him. You know, when I was in Indianapolis, where we stopped over, and I had my, I had a Indian buffet, $9.99, Indian food. Wow, it was really good. You realize there's no Indian restaurants any place, he told me, in Louisville. Like, one is like 18 miles away, another one's 22 miles away. There's not no vegetarian and stuff like that here. It's so weird because they do have downtown, and you would think, you know, you could have an Indian restaurant because no what happens in downtown. You know, people don't want to eat the same food all the time, so they, you know, but hey, that's something else. I was telling about, you know, I go to India, well, I used to go to India a lot. So I was in Machu Madeira, and I had the privilege of one time being in Machu Madeira because they go sort of guard in the morning, nobody comes to it. And I was there for like, you know, 45 minutes meditating through the big, you know, the big orb or whatever it is, you know. Don't worry about all that stuff. I'm just saying I travel a lot. But the reason why I say I travel, because I was told that I don't want anybody, they don't have to clean my room, you know, at all. And he said, oh, you're different because, you know, people, if they're 5 minutes late, they say to me, I have to clean my room, and they don't understand how many rooms it is and blah, 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 blah. But it's like, I sleep on one side. It's a king size bed. I sleep on one side of the bed. Next night, I sleep on the other side of the bed. Two nights that I'm here, three nights, whatever I'm here, I don't need nobody coming into this room. You know, I'm cool. You know, if I need some towel or washcloth, I just go get it, you know. And so I also went, I'm just giving you all these hints. You know, I went and I got some CVS. I went and got my own organic maple syrup. So when I had the oatmeal in the morning, I did have bagels. I don't really do that. You know, I had bagels in the morning. And, you know, I had it's a blueberry bagel. I usually just have cinnamon raisin, well, raisin bagel. So I had a half and half, put some cream cheese on there. Again, I don't do that, but I guess I'm falling off all my stuff. There's noodles, jelly, so I had that. But then I had the oatmeal, maple syrup. Got to have my maple syrup. So I bought that from CVS last night. And I also left, got a burger right here. I left that with a muffin. A little muffin for a little bit later. You know, I think this is bran raisin, something like that. So I have that later. I had my pacing for the book that we're supposed to be reading. You know, where do we go from here? KSO Community, Martin Luther King Jr., right? So I had my thing, I was pacing it out. So on the bus coming from Annapolis, whatever the hell it was, down there where the Colts, the football, you know, that the town, the bus ride is like 2.5 hours or 2 hours, whatever it is. But I sat next to a vet, you know, and we was talking, you know, he was like a single, it was just a white guy, don't worry about talking. I also met a sister just sitting in the back of us, Tiffany, but I didn't talk to her. I was talking to this vet, you know, because he had problems, you know what I mean? So I help everybody, don't matter what you are, right? So I couldn't get to read what I was going to read, but I sort of could have. Then this morning when I was reading, because last night I just zonked out, slept all night, which I usually don't do. I used to try to wake up somewhere in the middle of the night, you know, and then go back to sleep. Anyway, so my sister calls. Whoa! First of all, my sister is extraordinary. Let me just tell you this. But she's going through, what is she trying to be? I don't know, big time. She's the next nurse's level. Beyond physician assistant, then there's something else. I forgot. It's something real, big time, something between a doctor and a PA, you know, the big time thing. Anyway, so she's in doing a rotation for that, something she's doing like that. But because she has all this nursing experience, so she was good. So they handled the case where this the guy came in with the baby, whatever months old, And he had missed an appointment by a day, and he came in. I'm not even talking about school, I'm just telling what happened. And the grandmother was there, the guy's mother was there. And so my sister asked, they have to do an assessment before the doctor comes in. And I said, where's the mother? The mother, she's like my mama, had seven kids, right? And this last one, she has an aneurysm. She's in emergency room. So this guy's taking care of the baby by himself. He doesn't know what to do. So my sister gave me, anyway, long story short, it was really an amazing case. And it's all because my sister knows, I mean, look, my family is like unbelievably extraordinary for what everybody does, what they do. But I was so proud of her because she, and this doctor was very compassionate. Got this guy back on hopefully, you know, everything. Well, babies grow out of anything. So anyway, so this, whew. Anyway, let me leave that alone. That's not what we're talking about. So I missed, so I got a little bit more to read. I think, whatever time we are, it was 8 o'clock. I think 9 is one of the things. So I got to get going. I got to take a shower, change clothes, whatever, and get up to see Stephen's church, wherever it's at, you know, find out. Whenever we do this reading thing. But there was a passage I do want to read. Sorry it's taking so long, but because I've been marking up the book, because now this is my book. But I just want to read this one passage to you, because this is sort of important to me. There's a lot of stuff to hit. It's really good. It's on page 168. I'll just try to read it to you. Okay? We have many assets to facilitate organizations. Negroes are almost instinctively cohesive. Okay, remember this book is written in 1968. Okay, so language, right? We band together readily and against white hostility. We have an intense and wholesome loyalty to each other. Remember this back in 1968. In some of the simplest relationships, we will protect a brother even at the cost of ourselves. We are loath to witness against each other when the white man seeks to divide us. My, how things have changed. We are acutely conscious of the need and sharply sensitive to the importance of defending our own. Solidarity is a reality in Negro life, and as always, has always been among the oppressed. That's why I identify with the downtrodden all over the world. We're sort of like, okay, that's the problem. They created a Negro middle class and a Negro upper class, so the solidarity has been waning, let's say, since the boule was invented in the early 1900s. Anyway, back to the point. We are acutely conscious of the need and sharply sensitive to the importance of defending our own. Solidarity is a reality of Negro life, and as always, has been among the oppressed. Sometimes, unfortunately, it is misapplied when we confuse high status with high character. When we confuse high status with high character. On the other hand, Negroes are capable of becoming competitive, carping, and On the other hand, Negroes are capable of becoming competitive, carping, and in an oppression of self-hate, suspicious, and intolerant of each other. The glaring weakness in Negro life is lack of sufficient mutual confidence and trust. That is what I'm into, is trust. I think the thing that we have to deal with these days is trust. It's you know, who do you trust? How can you trust? And when you find that you should be trusting, you know what I mean? You find a trusting situation, I think we need to get into that trusting situation. That's my thing from that little thing. But the book is extraordinary. I mean, you should get it, even if you're not into any of this stuff. Because I think the enemies of the downtrodden, as I would say, they read that. And I think King was killed because of that, rather than anything else. Because remember, this is King between 1967 and 1968. Mm-hmm. This is not the I Have a Dream guy. You see? So, anyway. I'm going to the conference now. See what's going on. Blah, 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 blah. Talk to you later. I'm talking to you, me. Being T from the Patterson taking the train to Tibet, letting you know what I only suspect from a reality of the ADOS, that would be the North American descendants of chattel slavery.